Starting the webinar, the faculty development program. Good morning to all once again. I am Professor ESM Suresh, Professor and the Head of Civil and Environmental Engineering from National Institute of Technical Teachers Training and Research, Chennai. NITTR is under the Ministry of Human Resource Development, Government of India. We have four NITTRs in our country. NITTR Chennai is catering to the needs of all South Indians, engineering and polytechnic colleges. And similarly, Chandigarh for the northern region and Kolkata for the eastern region, and Bhopal for the western region. We conduct nearly 300 training programs in a year, both for the polytechnic colleges and the engineering colleges. And in fact, our Department of Civil and Environmental Engineering conducts nearly about 30 faculty development programs, including the international training programs every year. We also conduct academic programs. We offer master's degree in civil engineering, infrastructure engineering and management, and a PhD program in civil and environmental engineering, and of course, PhD in engineering education. It's a very famous program. At present, we are affiliated with the Anna University and the University of Madras, and we are in the process of getting the deemed university status. So coming to myself, I have 30 years of professional experience, 24 years at the National Institute of Technical Teachers Training and Research, Chennai. All of you kindly mute your mic. I require your kind cooperation for the next 1 hour of my presentation. And I joined this institute in the year of 1994. And before that, I was working in two different engineering colleges. And I was doing my PhD at Indian Institute of Science, Bangalore, before joining here. And I have guided six PhD scholars who have been successfully completed. Six more are working. So totally, I have guided 12 research scholars are working under my guidance. And I have completed more than 300 faculty training programs in my career, more than 25 international training programs. Recently, I have been honored as a distinguished visiting professor from University of Mascarenes in Mauritius. I have visited more than 15 countries abroad. You would have seen my bio data. Okay, coming to the presentation, I should thank Dr. Venkatesh Babu, Dean Academic Bharat University, DTP University, for giving this opportunity. You may wonder, what is this topic, modern challenges faced in the teaching learning process and how to overcome that? Okay, what is this challenge we are facing? You know, the engineering institutions of our country are facing a tremendous competition. Of course, we are in the difficult situation, COVID-19. I think this is one of the wonderful opportunity where we are able to get connected and still we are able to move forward in our professional activities. In the post-COVID situation, what are the challenges into our classroom teaching? And of course, you people are busy in attending a number of webinars, online courses, and you get wonderful experience in different platforms, Zoom, and you have a Google Meet. Now you are attending in Cisco WebEx. Different platforms, different types of experience you are gaining. And how far this online education will be useful in terms of delivering the content, more than delivering the content on the learning part. That is the biggest challenge. I'm not against the online education system or a conventional education system. In fact, I am for the learning The learning should happen more than the mode of delivery. If you look into the great challenge what we are facing, the great challenge is actually to increase the gross enrollment ratio. Many of us are thinking that, do we require so many engineering colleges for this country? I strongly accept and support. You require more engineering institutions, but you should produce more employable engineers. More employable engineers will happen only when you have quality content delivery. Many institutions are actually building very good infrastructures, but very limited institutions only facing the teaching learning process. As I was telling, the great challenge what we are facing is actually to increase the gross enrollment ratio. If you try to compare our gross enrollment ratio with the other countries, our gross enrollment ratio is only 25%. Whereas if you take China, it is about 50 plus, and the US, Canada, and other developed countries are more than 80%. So we are under tremendous pressure to increase the gross enrollment ratio. Okay, we have increased the number of institutions, but are our engineering graduates are employable? That's the biggest challenge. So we move from a normal education to outcome-based education. The outcome-based education focusing on student-centric learning. The outcome-based education focusing on the employability. I always say outcome is the employability or the employment. Output is the passed out students. If you take about 2 decades back, we were more worried only about the pass percentage. If you ask the question, who is the best teacher? The teacher who produced very good results. But it is not so now. The biggest challenge is actually to produce employable engineers. In this country, I always say, employment is not a problem. Employability is the problem, or underemployment is the issue. Unemployment is not the problem. You need to provide good education. The good education in the sense, the products which are being produced should be ripened naturally, should be accepted by the industry. How it is possible? The food should be cooked well in the kitchen. The food should be processed well in the kitchen. It is going to be the buyer's market. It is going to be the customer's driven economy. We always say the students are our customers. No, they are not the customers. Now the new terminology, they are the stakeholders. What is the difference between the customer and the stakeholder? Customer is the person who just buys the product, but the stakeholder is the person who is involved in the process. So I'm coming to the topic. The process is here is a teaching learning process. Like you are processing your food, like you are cooking your food. If your process is good, then the product will be good. If your content delivery is good, if it is being accepted by the students, your content, and naturally, it reaches the minds of the students, they learn. They learn in terms of 3 important domains: knowledge, skill, and the attitude. Okay, with this information or the introduction, let me move on to my topic. Okay. What are the areas in which we are going to discuss? The first point, of course, this is my overview of my presentation. We are going to see teaching learning process today. In today's teaching learning process, what is happening? Anything different in the modern days of learning? Just because you have used the technology, anything happening drastically? That's the biggest question to be answered. Then the basic teaching model, you should understand what is the basic teaching model, what are the components involved in the models, what are the functions of each component, how you can actually design the component so that your model will be efficient, effective in delivering the content. Then building the abilities, that's the biggest challenge. Building the ability is a key success for the teacher. Building the abilities of the students. Okay, what are the components of ability? Again, knowledge, skill, and the attitude. Then only the learning is complete. Then only the ability of, you know, the acquiring the ability will happen. Then we will see principles of learning. What is the basic principle behind the learning? You should understand the theory behind the learning. Then teacher competency. You would have seen, he's the competent person. He is a competent teacher. Again, the competency in terms of knowledge, skill, and the attitude. You would have seen the teachers who are knowledgeable but poor in delivering the content in the classroom, poor in delivering the content in your online teaching, poor in delivering the content in terms of the learning styles of the students. Okay, then outcome-based education. What is outcome-based education? That's what we are all now moving towards the next, very important change in our, the system is actually the outcome-based education. The outcome of the process is very, very important. The outcome of the process, the outcome of our teaching is very, very important. The outcome will happen only when learning happens. When the learning will happen, there is a behavioral change. Before attending my session, I was not knowing. Before attending this class, I was not knowing. But after attending, what is the significant change? After you teach to your students, what is the significant change? Okay, then evolution of computer-based learning. Okay, how the computer-based learning happens? It is not happening just incidentally. Over the night, it is not happening. For the past 3 to 4 decades, the computer-based learning is happening. Different platforms, different media, different ways of reaching the people. Of course, the technology changes. I always say technology is very, very dynamic. You say 2G, 3G, 4G, 5G, and all that. But the teacher is very, very important. No technology can replace the teacher even after a century. That's what I'm going to emphasize in this presentation. No technology can replace a teacher. But remember, my dear teachers, no teacher can be successful without making use of the technology. You should be able to adapt yourself. Yes, I'm 53 years old. I'm able to adapt all the technology. If you are not using the technology, you will be thrown away from the system. That's very, very important. Don't say that I don't want the technology. Yes, technology is required. But how to make use of the technology to reach the people's mind is very, very important. Then, e-learning implementation. Okay. How the e-learning is being implemented? What are the challenges? What are the issues? What is the best platform? How you can choose the platform? How you can develop your e-content, your electronic content? You can share video, you can share audio, or you can share a kind of animation. How much proportion? That's very, very important. Okay, if you deliver your content only by video, right? Like what you have it in your YouTube. Will it reach the minds of the people? There is a philosophy on developing the e-content or content for e-learning. It's called four-quadrant approach. We have defined. We are going to see in this presentation. video, audio, and your quiz, and a kind of activity. This four quadrant approach, if you try to develop the video, there will be a kind of proportion which will help you to deliver the content very effectively. Then, what are the e-learning platforms? What are the e-learning platforms available today in our country? You should be able to get the information. In fact, we spend a lot of money, Government of India spends a lot of money on developing the, you know, the platforms. I'll be showing a lot of platforms, especially on Swayam, how we are delivering the content. In fact, in Swayam platform, I have delivered 2 times on quality assurance in engineering education, 40 hours, 3 credit codes. First time I had 3,000 participants, second time, just now I have completed, it is about second cycle, and 2 more on the National Resource Center, RPIT, in our civil engineering department, we got it, along with all the centrally and no funded institution, we are the only institution who got this. Fine. Coming to the biggest challenge. The biggest challenge, as I told you, develop a teaching learning process which should be sustainable, which should be adaptable, which should be acceptable. One of the interesting challenge, as per National Knowledge Commission, if you see, a teacher should be student-centric. A teacher should not be a teacher-centric approach. What are the issue or the problems today? Our approach is teacher-centric. We fail to understand the requirements of the students. We conduct examination at the end. I always say examination is only incidental evaluation. Your 12 years of school education is being tested at the end, within 3 years, within 4 walls, and ultimately it is deciding who is the winner in the race. We forget the importance of continuous assessment in this country. The importance of continuous assessment we will be discussing. That is one of the, you know, the issue pointed out by the National Knowledge Commission from Dr. Sam Putida. You all know very well. Okay. The teacher never asks why I am teaching this. That is the first important question to be, you know, the answered, like why I should teach this content. Why I should teach this content? Yes, I should teach this content for the benefit of to whom? Yes, just a minute. Yeah, it's on the laptop. Yes, I should know why I am teaching this. Who are all getting benefited? What the students will do after this exposure? Fine. What are the kinds of activities should be engaged to have the learning opportunities? You see, wonderful word, learning opportunity. You should provide a wonderful opportunity of learning. Learning should be comfortable. Learning should be pleasant. Learning should never be a burden. I should have a different learning experience. You know, when you are delivering the content, no student today can pay their attention for more than 15 minutes. Many research articles, you have the evidence. I hope you are all with me physically, of course, holding the headphone and all that. But I'm not sure mentally how many of you with me. This is what happening in the classroom. When you start delivery, most of them will be in the initial phase of your delivery, because there will be some motivation component. Because when you are delivering your session or the content, basically, there are 4 phases you should have it. Introductory phase, development phase, evaluation phase, and then summarizing. So most of them will be with you only during the introductory phase or the development of the lesson. How to retain their interest? That's a very big challenge for the teacher. So for that, you should have varieties of strategies. Different strategies of teaching you should adapt. Different modes of delivery. different types of media which you should use it. Okay, your presentation should be a vibrant presentation. Okay, there should be a component called a stimulus variation. What is the stimulus variation? You have a brain, billions and billions of neurons. Every neuron has got billions and billions of interconnectivity. How the learning happens? When you provide the information, it reaches the neuron and activates. It should activate. Then only learning will happen. There is a photo, you know, chemical reaction between the neurons. The information is getting passed through the cells. So your presentation should take care of the stimulus variation. Lack of multidisciplinary. There is no interdisciplinary approach. As a civil engineer, I should know Industry 4.0. I should know IoT, Internet of Things, the project management skills, the computational skills, managerial skills, very, very important, managing the people. So it's not merely studying about the civil engineering. It is studying about the holistic engineering, the holistic engineering of, you know, the particular domain. No opportunity is being given to the learner to walk out or walk into our, you know, the big education system to earn their certification. That's a very big challenge. It will take many years. You have a philosophy called multi-point entry and exit system. Many developed countries, they have got it. A student who is studying for 4 years, suppose he wants to finish or he is getting the opportunity or some problem, he can get out of the system. Like he, suppose he is getting out from the system by 3 years, so he should be able to get whatever he learned. For that, there should be some kind of certification. No scope to introduce the latest knowledge in the curriculum. So I always say, teaching learning process is like a cooking. Curriculum, what? That is your framework design. What are the different ingredients that you should add? How the curriculum should be? It should not be like a served lunch. It should be like a buffet. The student should be able to pick up the item that whatever he wants. It's not that what we deliver, but what he wants. That should be a component in the curriculum. This is what we say in the outcome-based education, the philosophy, it starts from OBE-based curriculum, OBE-based teaching learning process, and outcome-based assessment. And finally, the learning goals of the course, learning objectives of the units are very, very important. You should know at the end of your instruction what the student should be able to know. Okay. So coming to this very interesting aspect called the information versus instruction. Let us understand this. A teacher provides the information is a good teacher. Can you accept? I always compare with the newsreader. A newsreader also provides a lot of information. Okay, what is the basic difference between the newsreader and the teacher? Newsreader also provides the information like you. Then the news reader is reaching the goals of the, you know, the total process. No, he is providing the information. I always say in a funny way, the news reader will never ask at the end, have you understand or have you understood what I have delivered? No. So the teacher is more worried about the assessment. Yes, whatever I have delivered, this is whether they are reaching the minds of the people. So the information is actually only just passing on the message. But the instruction is, what is the behavioral change? What is that, you know, the happening because of my delivery? Fine. So the learning process. Okay. Learning process. The learning is actually acquiring the knowledge, skill, and the attitude. That is the change of the behavior. The behavior should happen in terms of all the three domains equally. You say he's a knowledgeable engineer, but he is not competent. What is the meaning? A knowledgeable engineer, but not a competent personality. That means he is not able to perform the job. There is one component or a portion of the component is missing, maybe attitude. A good knowledge and the skill, more than that, the driving force is the attitude. Okay. Attitude is a fire. Attitude finally decides. He may be a knowledgeable teacher, but he doesn't have the interest to deliver the content, interest to deliver the process. Okay. So this is what happening when the student gives the, you know, for example, when the student getting into the system, probably they are not knowing, but after your process, they know something. Your teaching learning process, they learn something. You measure it. Yes, I measure it. In the measurement, I have a substance. I could see a kind of substance is there on the minds of the people. That is actually reflected in terms of the terminal behavior. Fine. This is a very interesting graph you try to see. Learning model. This is actually the linear learning model. In the linear learning model, you could see the y-axis is the objectives. X-axis is the content. Z-axis is 3M. What is this 3M? Materials, media, and the methods. Okay, let us take this X content. You have a content that we are fixing it in the X coordinate. It is not sufficient. When you deliver the content, you should be able to measure how it can be measured. So the y-axis in the objectives, the linear, you know, the scale, maybe the green line, if you try to see, it is moving from origin 0, 0, 0 to x, y, z. You should have the proper content and you should be able to measure it. How it is possible? Using a good material, maybe it is a print material or a non-print material. What is print material? Your book, a textbook, all your print material, handouts, everything. Then the media, your PowerPoint, your video you are sharing, they are all the media. Method, different methods of teaching we are going to see now. Okay, all these three combinations contributing for the effective learning. Fine. This is what happening in the situation model of the engineering education today. Every academic institution with a very good infrastructure, when the student is coming out of the institution, it's the biggest challenge for him. He should be accepted by the industry. That's the biggest challenge. As I told you, the fruits should be ripe. The fruit should be accepted by the, you know, the customer. I always say the shopping is being changed. The shopping, you know, the style is being changed. A few years back, we used to go to different stores for buying different items. Going to grocery store for buying the grocery item, going to vegetable shop for buying the vegetables, going to, you know, the medical shop for buying the medicines. It is not so now. You have a shopping mall, going to big shopping mall. Shopping is becoming a very big entertainment. Now, what is the purpose here? All the products are being displayed. You can choose the product based on your MRP, based on your brand, based on so many factors. You are being actually given the liberty to buy based on your wish. Similarly, when the industry is actually standing in front of the gate of the academic institution, when the students are coming out, whether the students possess the required knowledge, skill, and the attitude. It's called engineering knowledge. Engineering skill, engineering behavior. We will understand more about this in the coming the slides. Okay. How it is possible when you provide quality education? When you provide a good experience of learning, so the academic program should be good in terms of curriculum, in terms of very good teaching learning process, in terms of all the, you know, the assessment which you follow it and all that. So good operational, you know, the environment, good environment for the, you know, the students to enjoy the, you know, the student life. Okay, coming to this basic teaching model, it's a very simple model. There are four components. Instructional objectives. You should frame the objectives. Now you say course outcome. Okay, it is very specific. Outcome is very specific in terms of three domains: knowledge, as I told you, skill, and the attitude. The better way of measurement. Then entry behavior, the raw material. If you choose the best raw material, if you have good students, if your admission is good, I always say, I forgot to tell you, I am working as the, you know, the assessor for the NBA as a program evaluator. I am also going as a chairman for different institutions I am visiting. I always see when the student admission is good in a, you know, the institution, that's an important criteria. I always say, if the admission is good, naturally the output will be good. If your raw material is good and the products will be good, the products will be sold like a hot cake, provided you should have a better teaching learning process and all the issues what we are discussing. But remember, raw material is very, very important. I always say, today engineering education, it is not like a premier education when we had the education 3-4 decades back. It was like a premier education, now it is mass education. Okay, mass education is required. As I told you, we need to improve the gross enrollment ratio. But remember, quality should never be compromised. Then the instructional procedures we'll be discussing. Then the best performance assessment tool you should design. Fine. Okay, every teacher is more worried about the feedback. Why the feedback is required? I deliver the content. Whether the content is appropriate, whether it is adequate, sufficient to meet the requirements of the grade students. Then the quality, conforming to the requirements, the standards, okay, the customer needs, whether it is useful for their goals. Somebody wants to go for higher study, somebody wants to go for the placement, or an entrepreneur, self-employment, startup is interested. Okay, whether it is serving the purpose, fine. What is happening in this domain, instruction and the teaching? A great, you know, the words. As I told you, the instruction changes the behavior at the faster rate. Okay. What are the basic modes of instruction? Two modes, basic modes. You all know very well, brick and mortar learning, conventional learning, face-to-face learning. It is not, and we should not underestimate the face-to-face learning. In fact, the post-COVID-19, you would have seen, or you may see, sorry, you may see your students will come to you, yes, I want more face-to-face learning than online education. Probably they would have become bored with so many online education platforms which they would have attended during this period. Then the technology-enabled learning, use of technology for teaching learning purpose. That is a major focus of our discussion. Whether Technology enabled learning will replace the conventional learning. That is the debate. That is the argument in which I am proceeding. Okay. Finally, let us see what is the result. How much percentage you want? Yes, I want only the technology, not the teacher. Or I want only the teacher, not the technology. We are going to see now. Teaching basically involves human interaction between a teacher and the learner. Between you and me, there is an interaction. Even in the classroom, of course, we are getting connected thanks to this technology. Even in the classroom, when you deliver the content, they listen. There is a Wi-Fi connectivity between you and the students. Okay. This is where you are getting connected. Fine. Building abilities. How will you build the ability? Morning to evening, only the one strategy. Continuously, you are teaching the subject. Only lecture method, morning to evening. Unfortunately, in our system, we are unable to understand the learning styles of our students. As I told you, no student can pay their attention for more than 15 minutes. The research indicates more than 40 plus learning styles exist today. We assume that all our learners are same. All of their competencies are same. All of their learning styles are same. All of their level of understanding is same. The basic knowledge is same. Many things we assume, they are all same for the learners. We teach them. Just for fun, I just tell you, my dear teachers and my dear participants, maybe if other friends. At the end of the session, suppose I conduct a small test. Don't mistake me, I will not conduct. Maybe I will try to interact more. All of you will score the same marks? No. Why? Based on so many factors. Because all are not same, all are not paying their attention. Many factors which are influencing. Okay. There are three major domains in the ability building. First one is cognitive ability. What is cognitive? Something happens in your brain. Can you tell me, or can I ask you the question, which organ will come in the fetus, 4 to 6 weeks of the fetus? Heart or brain? Heart will come first, or the brain will come first? If you think about these two, heart will come first in the 4th to 6th week. Then only the brain will come. God has given the priority for the heart, but in our life we give more importance for the brain. We think that more the brain, more the knowledge, more the knowledge, more the information, more the information, more the money, more the money, more the happiness. That is where we fail in the life. Don't mistake me. Then psychomotor. Your finger dexterity, your hand movement. Okay? Your hand movement. Many things are skills. Many skills you try to actually focus today. I just tell you, our friend is getting married. He is getting a BMW car. Okay? His father-in-law asked him to drive the car. The friend says he doesn't know the driving. The father-in-law says, take the BMW car manual, see the instruction, drive the car. Is it possible? No. BMW car manual gives all the the instructions, diagrams, everything. Will it be sufficient to drive the car? Similarly, to learn swimming, somebody wants to jump into well. How to learn swimming? In 10 minutes, you learn this book. By reading that book, can you swim? Can you jump into the well? No. It requires reinforced practice, continuous practice. Skill development will happen only when you have a continuous, you know, the development, continuous practice. The hands are very important skills. Then coming to affective, third important component, but which is a very, very vital component. The heart. The heart is the affective domain. The feelings, emotions. Today, emotional quotient is very important, like your intelligent quotient, IQ, EQ is very important. How much interest, how much behavioral component? I always say in a funny way in civil engineering teaching, the concrete quality can be assessed. If you take 1:2:4 mix design, the characteristic strength of the concrete remains same whether you test in Chennai or in New Delhi or Tokyo of Japan or London of UK or New York of US. The characteristic strength remains same. It is not so, my dear friends, the behavioral component of a human being. Morning is different. The first of every month when you get the salary, you feel very happy. Happiness because of so many reasons. Okay, now it's a very difficult word for us. For all of us, we are more worried about the situation. So it is actually dynamic in nature, environmental conditions, and more dynamic. We should understand, more complex to understand. Very difficult to measure somebody's affective domain, behavioral component, which is very challenging. Okay, so total, all the three are very important in a good proportion. Okay, we'll take only knowledge. Now, David Bloom has given six important levels of measurement. Many people think that, no, Bloom is an old model. You require a modified Bloom or a David Merrill model. I always use all the three models. But I always say, when they write the course outcome, when they ask me, sir, Bloom's taxonomy, can I adopt? Or a David Merrill model, I can adopt. I always say it is only the unit of measurement. Whether you follow MKS or SI unit, but conceptualization, what is the size of the door? 3 feet. Or you tell me in centimeters. Okay, you should be able to tell. But which is very, very important is visualization. Okay, this is the size of the door. So following Bloom's taxonomy is nothing wrong, even though it is bold. But understanding is important. Understanding the Bloom's taxonomy is very important. Six levels, my dear friends, in the Bloom's taxonomy. The first level is the knowledge, then comprehension, application, analysis, synthesis, and evaluation. Six levels. We will see all the six levels one by one. First, let us take a knowledge. Okay. You ask some questions like this. Define a bending moment. State Chessy's law or a Kirchhoff's law, or list the advantages of lubricant. Everybody reproduces. It is based on rote memory system. Somebody, you know, gaining information and then reproducing it. Not very rigorous behavioral change happens. This is the problem in the knowledge level, lawyer level. But don't, misinterpret that a knowledgeable person in terms of lawyer level of, you know, the competent. No. A knowledgeable person here, what we say, it is the basic level of the achievement. Okay, fine. Then second one is comprehension. What is comprehension or an understanding level? The understanding level is the level which they understand and which they gain the knowledge from that they try to give examples, summarize, illustrate. You just see the examples, differentiate between centripetal force and centrifugal force. Unless I understand what is centripetal force and the centrifugal force, you will not be able to correlate or differentiate between these two. And then explain the working of a DC motor. Or explain such a powerful action verb. The action verbs plays a significant role on the level of understanding. Achievement. The indicator. Many times I observe the course outcome with the action verb understand. How you can measure the understanding or appreciate? How you can measure somebody is able to appreciate? They are all very complex terms. Right? So avoid those terms. Instead, use explain. Use differentiate. Classify. Something that you want to visualize at the end of the instruction. Okay, fine. Then the third level, application level. The application level, the ability to use the rules, principles, methods, generalization, with the new students are the one. You ask a question, calculate the voltage across a given electrical network, the students have to do a lot of calculations. Solving the first order differential equation or solving the G. So many things are actually in the application level. If you try to see the higher order ability, the lower order ability is knowledge and understanding. The higher order ability starts from application level, analysis level, or a synthesis level, evaluation level. Let us see what is the analysis level. Here, a learner should be able to break down into component parts, may include identification of the parts, analyzing the relationship between the parts, recognition of principles. Okay, visualization. See the examples. Analyze digital IC family. Troubleshoot refrigerator. Analyze the motion of an electron in electric circuits or magnetic fields. You see, it's a very important. This is where you can measure the competency in a better way. The level of understanding is better here, the next level. Okay, putting the parts together, synthesis, higher order ability again. Design an IC engine. Plant layout, you would have taught them, but they should be able to revise it. Okay, for that you require this component, putting the parts together and then trying to correlate with whatever the learnings which they have done it. Then judge the value of criteria, evaluation. See, finding the efficiency of an engine. Okay, given condition, what is the best, the possible methods, or evaluate the suitability of double curved roof structure. Okay, let us go a little faster. What are the principles of learning? I'm just sharing this PPT. Don't bother about it. This PPT will be available with the admin. You can get it from them. No problem. Okay. So the principles of learning, it starts from learner or the student to learn more quickly and easily when they can integrate the new ideas. Okay. And then active participation of learners in the teaching learning process is the prerequisite. Remember, the learner should never be a passive learner. They should be active. And then different learning outcomes require different but appropriate instructional methods. We'll be seeing, not the same method. Learners differ in the ways in which they learn and the rate at which they learn. Individual differences, XY differences. X is not same as Y. Y is not same as Z. Okay, and then wide range of
Right,
learning experiences are to be provided to meet the individual needs. What is the type of learning, I know the experience you are trying to give? Yes, I offer a subject. I always say to my students, it's not like scoring the marks, whether you enjoy the subject, something you have learned, something new. Learning happens. Okay, many times in this, unfortunately, in our system, marks are the magic numbers. We try to measure somebody's ability. Somebody's ability. Just because he is sitting in the first bench, he is successful in the life. Classroom, he is sitting in the first bench. We always like the first bench students. They may become like us teachers. That's all. The last bench students are the people who will become politicians, are the, you know, the real, you know, the risk taking people. Okay, fine. Wide range of learning experiences to meet the individual needs. It's very difficult to design. You'll see in digital learning. Okay, fine. Motivated students learn effectively. Motivation is very important. What is motivation? Okay. Wonderful word, motivation. Something you do so that the person will be happy. Okay. I always say when I'm teaching to the, you know, this kind of training programs, suppose I give Cadbury's chocolate, all of you will stay with me for 3 hours. We all say, sir, we all will give 2 Cadbury's chocolate. You finish your session in time. Okay, just for fun. Cadbury's chocolate is a motivation. As per Maslow's motivation theory, the motivation component, it varies dynamic. Chocolate was very motivating element during their childhood days. But definitely, I would say those who are attending my session continuously, maybe for 4 hours, I'm going to wind up by, you know, 12:30 or 12 o'clock, okay? 12:56. I would recommend, every one of you to get a minimum of 1 or 2 increments in your college. All of you will be very happy because monetary benefit today at this age is very, very important, vital. It's a Maslow's theory, material needs changing. Students learn best by doing. Give the opportunity to do the things. Okay. The laboratory and the lecturing or a classroom teaching should be integrated. Many times when I ask the teacher, they say that, why did you join this profession? They say teaching job is a very peaceful profession. Are you accepting it? No, sir. It is not a peaceful profession. We have 40 dinosaurs in the class. No, don't mistake me. They are not the dinosaurs. They are the intellectual elements finding difficult to manage. Even their parents are finding difficult to manage, but you people are great to manage that. Okay. So you people are really great. Then spaced distributed recalls. Give them one experience. After some time, you give them the opportunity to recall. Provide them different learning, other experience. So, fine. Positive reinforcement facilitates learning. What is positive reinforcement? Token reinforcement. Somebody answer your question. There are different ways of questioning the students. We cover in our training program. It takes 1.5 hours for even for that particular subject. How to distribute the questions? We always pose the questions to the person to whom we want to attack. Come on, tell me, what is the answer for this question? Yesterday, I saw you moving with your girlfriend. Come on, ask me this question. What's the problem here? You are mixed up with the two things. Okay, you are attacking him. Fine. This is not the way. Questioning or evaluation is not the knife. Many times, examination is being treated like a battleground between the teacher and the student. It provides a comfortable situation to give to them to produce their answers comfortably. Fine. Real life requires doing the things rather than knowing the things. Doing the things is more important than rather knowing the things. Yes, I have learned. How much I can do, that's very, very important. Whether I have the interest to do, yes, that is the motivation. Third component. Okay, learning styles. We'll move to the next middle part of our discussion. 40 plus learning styles. But all the 40 plus learning styles I cannot discuss within this 1.5 hours of my session. Yes, three broad categories: visual learners, auditory learners, and kinesthetic learners. Who are all visual learners? You would have classified your students. They learn by watching. They're watching, imaging. Picture conveys millions of words. Seeing is believing. They enjoy by seeing the things. Auditory learners, they try to learn the things by hearing. Yes, learn through listening. Learn through talking. Fine. Kinesthetic learner, action. Kinetics, like to perform the procedures themselves, action oriented. Yes, I want to do the things rather than seeing, rather than hearing. I want to perform. I want to drive my car, then only I can actually learn. I want to swim myself, jump into the well. Yes, action. Visual learners focus on details rather than the whole task. Okay. Auditory learners remember the names. You would have seen many teachers, they remember the names but not the faces. Okay. Kinesthetic learning here may be poor listeners, but they tend to fidget, they tend to move off and they supplement with their words, with their gestures, body language. In fact, I always, you know, see the teacher with the body language, non-verbal communication. Verbal communication, something you talk. The verbal communication, you should concentrate your pitch of your voice, voice modulation. You would have seen the fingers. You should raise your tone, reduce your tone. It should not be monologue. There should be an amplitude component. There should be ups and downs in your, you know, the voice modulation. Okay. Non-verbal communication, your body language, your facial expression, eye-to-eye contact, your hand movement, they all correlate, synchronizes. They are all helping you to deliver the content very effectively. Remember, my dear friends, I'm not forgetting the platform. It could be online learning or it could be a brick and mortar learning. But these three important things are very, very important. Fine. What are the implications in the classroom? Okay. Learner diversity. Diversified learners. Yes. All are not same. I have been continuously telling. So you should devise a method of teaching based on that. We are going to see that. All the learners in the classroom do not always benefit from traditional instruction. Don't think negative about the traditional teaching. I always say traditional teaching, it's like your motherhood food. Or online teaching is something like a fast food. Huh? Don't mistake me. Like, in a funny way, I try to see that the younger generation, Gen Y learners, they say that, the technology, they are addicted to the technology. What are the problems with the technology-enabled learning? In few minutes, we are going to see that. Fine. I leave these components for your self-learning. Okay, coming to the teacher competency. Three aspects of teacher competency. Best teacher. The best teacher. Yes, he is the best teacher. How you can define the best? How you say that he is the best teacher? The teacher who knows the subject, the content, the knowledge. For example, if you take a cake, the bottom portion of the cake is the carbohydrate part. The top portion is the cream. The cream is only for the attraction, but cream will never give the energy. Similarly, you have your pizza, your children would have liked. The topping is only for the attraction, not for energy giving. The bottom portion is the energy giving. The bread portion is the energy giving. So content, then the communication skill is very important. I know the subject, but I should be able to deliver, reaching the minds of the people. Okay, it's not like only the verbal communication, as I told you. The non-verbal communication by use of technology and all that, fine. Pedagogy. Okay, the holistic aspect. How do you design your instruction? Okay, understand your learners. They are all coming here in the pedagogy. Of course, when we are dealing with adult, maybe age-old teachers, I always say they are not pedagogy, they are all andragogy. Okay, now I hope answered your question, who is an effective teacher reaching the minds of the people? You would have observed your own colleagues. There are some colleagues, they are very, very friendly. They are all being attracted by the student. They move with the students very closely. Okay, there are two extremes. There are teachers, they go with the students to the theaters, watch the movie and all that. Doesn't mean that, you know, in the long lasting, they will be like, you know, who is an effective teacher? Yes, the great motivator, the good classroom manager, good curriculum developer, the best teaching learning process who implemented many, many dimensions for the teacher. The best career guidance person, the good placement officer. So now you understand teaching job is a very complex job. Fine. Okay. How you can define the critical effective behavior of the teacher? One should be alert, appears enthusiastic, energetic. The energy level should never be reduced. Appears interested in the students and the classroom activities. Go with a lot of interest, okay? And don't try to pose only your ideas. Listen to them, enjoy your teaching, okay? And then cheerful, optimistic, positive. Okay, go to the classroom with a positive mind. Don't go with the sad, don't go with your personal feelings, okay? Self-controlled, not easily upset, okay? Yeah, that's what emotional quotient, EQ will play a significant role. Is fear impartial and objective in the treatment? Many, many things are there. Maybe I leave it to maybe for your the one. Fine. What is the spectrum of the instructional methods? I classify different methods on two extreme conditions. One is the highest degree of teacher control, and other one is the lowest degree of teacher control. That means if you take lecture method, your role is more. If you take self-study, where the student role is more. You see, two possible extremes. So the student's participation, the individual learning is more on the right-hand side than compared to the left-hand side. Your lecture method is a teacher-centric method. Your demonstration is a teacher-centric method. Lab work, of course, teacher-centric. And move on to your student-centric, your computer-assisted instruction, CAI, teaching, project work, self-study, and all that. I don't need to explain all this. You all know very well, friends. But remember, don't try to use only one method. All the methods are very, very important. I'm not talking about the platform or not talking about the different mode. No, the conventional teaching versus online teaching. Even in the online teaching, you should be able to adopt different strategies more towards student learning, student-centric methods rather than teaching. So what is the philosophy behind the learner-centered? Emphasizing on fulfilling the needs of the learner, because they are all our stakeholders. As I told you, they are not the customer, they are the stakeholder. As I told you, they are involved in the process. I buy a Peter England shirt. I'm not involved in the process of making the shirt. I'm only enjoying the product. That means I'm the customer. Stakeholders are not like that. stakeholders who are involved in the design of, starting from the design of the curriculum, teaching learning process, assessment, everything, so on. In the affiliation mechanism, you have all this disadvantage. You cannot design your own curriculum. You have to teach 40 hours. You have to conduct examination for the university, conventional system. Yes, all these problems are there. You have to come out of them. Okay, that's where the student-centric learning and the learner-centric approach is starting. Student will be active, responsible participants in their own learning. Give them the freedom. Give them the freedom to, you know, learn. Strengthen the motivation. Student-centric methods strengthen their motivation. Promotes peer group communication. You give the freedom to interact. Let them interact. Okay. Build the better student relationship. Okay. Promotes active learning. Fine. Learners intend to be employable. All these factors, okay, towards achieving your own target. Fine. There are two diagrams, of course. I think these two diagrams are there visible. Okay. Student decides on in the student learning. Learning objectives. Okay, this is what I have to learn at the end. I should be able to measure course content. This is what I want. Don't force me to learn this. I want this content. Like as I told you, go to the supermarket, you choose the item, or in a buffet in the lunch, you choose the item. When the thali meals is being served, you waste. Just to know, you would have seen, you may waste many items which are being served. But here you choose only what you want. You don't actually force them to take it. Okay. Learning resources. Okay. A teacher should be a resourceful person. Provide them a lot of materials. I'm going to talk about blended learning approach. Okay. Even the flipped classroom, you'll see. Time of assessment. Okay. When you should assess. Be learner oriented, not the teacher centric. That's a very important point of our discussion. Learning is more important than the teaching. Okay. But learning never happens unless teaching happens. That's very, very important. Fine. Coming to the outcome-based education. So three important domains, as I told you, knowledge, attitude, skills. Such a wonderful diagram. You see, knowledge and the attitude, when they overlap, you get a purpose. If there is a purpose, definitely, they both of them will overlap. Then skills. Then you have process. Skill and the attitude, you have the commitment. When the ability will happen, as I told you, building the ability. Right proportion of the knowledge. Yes, I know. I want to do. I have the interest to do. It's not like I know. I don't want to do, I don't have the interest. Okay, you get the point. Knowing, doing with more interest. That's the outcome-based education. Okay, there are major components, key constituents on that, rushing up because it takes more time. You all know very well in the outcome-based education, you have different levels, starting from your vision, mission, program educational objectives, program outcome, and course outcome. You have graduate attributes defined in the Washington Accord, 12 graduate attributes. How the engineering graduate should be, engineering graduate characteristics, when they are coming out of the institution, as I told you, the fruit should be ripe. How you can measure the properties of the product. 12 graduate attributes. What is vision? Yes, every institution, they have a dream. You have a dream that should be conceived by, adopted by every individual of that organization, the teacher, student, all the stakeholders, as I told you. It's not only for the management, it's being displayed in the principal chapter or it's being displayed. Everybody should understand, work towards it. Okay, what is mission? The ways and means of reaching the goal, reaching the vision. The steps or the strategies. For example, your son says, That I want to become like a Dhoni, Mahendra Singh Dhoni. Okay. In overnight, it cannot happen. You have to take him to the cricket ground, give them the practice. First of all, you should get more and more training, you know, more and more experience. Then you should play in the district level matches, state level matches, Ranji Trophy matches, then the national matches, the international matches. Then only it is possible. So this is actually the mission. Then the program educational objectives. Okay, you produce the, you know, the students. Okay, they are all employable. They are all employed in the industry. They are working in the industry. After 5 years, you want to measure them. Okay, whatever you have given the input in the academic institutions, whether they are contributing for them to actually practice in the industry. When you call them, you are alumni. You know, many times in the accreditation visit, when we ask them to show their alumni meet records, yes, sir, we have conducted the alumni meeting. Beautiful photograph. They all come with a family. They all had a dinner with us, cultural programs and all that. That is not the purpose for which the alumni meet is being organized. Alumni should give the input for the curricular revision, designing the proper instruction. Put them in the laboratory learning. Make them to actually, you know, get involved all your process. Yes, after 5 years of graduating from this institution, whatever the inputs you have given, whether they are useful, that is the input you get it so that you can modify. As I told you, outcome-based education is for the continuous improvement. It is not that, yes, I have reached this, I don't want to do anything further. No, I should be ready. I should be ready to learn myself, change myself. That's a concept in the strategic planning. We say blue version strategy, BOS, like a sea. You cannot see the, you know, end point of the sea. So the strategy is very important for every institution to have a very effective strategic plan. You can have my model strategic planning in the, you know, the SIAM platform. Fine. Program The program outcomes, as I told you in the gate, when the engineering graduates are coming out, they are being measured in terms of graduate attributes. Okay, then the course outcome. The course, every course you offer, at the end of the course, you should be able to measure it in terms of their learning. Okay, fine. We all been, no, we have been discussing about that. So basically, this is the OBE framework. You have the outcome, as I told you. Outcome in terms of the employability, output is only the pass-out percentage. Okay, you produce engineers, but you should be able to produce employable engineers. That's very, very important. Okay, then you have mission, vision, your engineering graduate attributes, PEO, student outcome, pro learning outcome. It is linked with the assessment. Okay, the course assessment for the course. At the end of the program, you have the program assessment, okay? And then the institutional assessment, we always say, whether it is the program assessment or the program measurement or institutional. The NBA, National Board of Accreditation, for the program measurement, for the particular program, we give the accreditation. NAC is for the overall, the institution. It is not for the specific program. Here, we concentrate more on the outcomes. More on the outcome-based education. Okay, fine. So you should have good planning, syllabus, teaching methods, learning activities, assessment tools, and all that. Fine. So summarizing that, this component, course outcome upon course completion, program outcome upon graduation, program educational objectives after 4 to 5 years, you can get only from the alumni. Okay, coming to the digital learning now. Okay, I am not actually jumping straight away. See, I am the same person. Okay, only platform is getting changed. I have, you know, the number of the participants who are sitting in front of me, but I am not able to see. Of course, I can see if I want or if they want. Okay, fine, that's different. But it's not happening so easily. Over the 3 decades, In fact, 1970s, the radio, All India Radio, your radio, you were trying to provide the information. Yes, weather report. We used to make a fun in the All India Radio when they make a statement that tomorrow is going to be rain. No, in the All India Radio, they have informed, so rain definitely will not come. It's not that today the prediction weather report so accurate. You know very well, our generation, 2 decades back, we had only one channel, Doordarshan channel. If you want to watch a movie, Tamil movie, you have to wait till Sunday. Okay. Or a national movie. Okay. And if you want to watch film songs, you have to wait till Friday evening. So in Tamil, it is volume, volume. Today, how many channels? Oh, 600 plus. Husband wants to watch news channel, wife wants to watch mega serials. Okay. Mother-in-law versus daughter-in-law problem, or your daughter or the son wants to watch the sports channel. Different people, different, the interest. In the classroom, you assume that 40 learners with different interests, different learning experience they want. So that is possible in the digital platform. Okay. You have umpteen number of videos available in the YouTube. Okay. And number of the different the learning providers, service providers, you see, service providers. Okay, like what I had, only BSNL, now different service provider. You can have 2 service providers also in your mobile phones were used only for communication. Today mobile phone is the best platform for the teaching learning. One of my PhD scholars, she did in about 15 years back on using the mobile phone, about 10 years back, not 15 years, sorry, on using the mobile phone inside the classroom. I'm not against the many institutions or a few institutions or a limited institution who are against using the mobile phone inside the classroom. The mobile phone is the best audiovisual tool. Use it in the classroom. But how to use the mobile phone? Okay. The best LMS, learning management system, we should have it. Okay. So I use Google Classroom. Yes, very simple to use it. Very simple to use it. I also use Moodle. Yes, I'm able to categorize everything, learners, their learning experience, how much they are showing interest, how many of them are present, how many of them are leaving my session, everything I could see now, thanks to the platform. Okay, e-learning is the mode of learning. Same learning, mode of learning facilitated and supported by ICT tools. Information, communication and technology. That's our definition. Different definitions. One more definition. E-learning mode and related tools provides a platform. What for? To enhance the learning, to facilitate the learning, for cost-effective delivery. See, cost-effective. Wonderful. I can have all my PowerPoint changes. Everything can be done, digital world. I just quote one more example. 2 decades back, we had only conventional photography camera, where you could see only, you could have used only the film rolls. You can take only 36 shots, 36 frames. Something happens in one, the frame, that too will come to know only after washing. You need to spend 90 rupees for that film roll and then another 200 for the washing. After spending 300 rupees only, you'll get how many, the print. Today, how many? It is so many, types of, the
ओके सर।
Somebody is texting me and putting the text that he has a problem in routing. You are able to hear? Can you say you are able to hear?
Yes, sir.
Thank you, thank you. What are the issues and challenges? I was talking about characteristics. The content is dynamic. Okay, dynamic content, you can change the content, edit the content. Then systematic learning experience. Okay, learning is smooth, comfortable. There is no option, no like a rugged, like a ridges on the roads, potholes on the roads. You travel your vehicle, very smooth drive, comfortable drive. Distributed content, fine, you can come. Deliver the content in a distributed way. You can put a condition that this can be opened only that point of time. It is suitable for this learner, suitable for that learner, and all that flexibility. Continuous learning, yes, happening comfortably. Personalized content, you can customize the content based on the needs. Fine. Non-linear content, somebody jumps into third lesson. Okay, instead of learning second lesson, yes, it is possible. Non-linear. In the video editing tools also, you have non-linear editing. Okay, non-linear. At any point of time, you can jump into the content, whatever you want. Okay. Then, learner-centric approach, very much. E-learning is the highest, you know, the component on the learner-centric approach. Learners are very important here. They are all being empowered. Yes, they can switch off and go. Okay, they don't want, they can switch off and go. Learner centric. Fine. Then, what are the problems with the e-learning today? That's a very important point. As I told you, just because it is technology, you will not have any problem. No, there will be some issues in the implementation. First one is the bandwidth issue. This is what we are focusing now. We are using Zoom, then Google Meet, and I'm using WebEx. Okay, I have used all the three things. I'm using it every day continuously. So the bandwidth also I am comparing, which is best. Because I have a student who is sitting in the remote area, Dharapuram. Jeez, don't mistake me. Dharapuram is not a very far away, I mean, remote place, but still in the end part of Tamil Nadu, or even remote village. You should be able to, you know, connect to you. Connectivity is important in the e-learning. Low adoption rate. Computer literacy, that's a very challenging task. Age-old people. Still, you know, I don't have any problem. I'm able to adapt it, okay? Only the motivating factor, driving force. Difficulty in engaging the learners online, managing them in the online. Somebody will mute the mic and the camera. We'll do some other job. You cannot see them. I'm not seeing my participants, what they are doing. Don't mistake me. Somebody would have muted the video and mic and they would do something else. You cannot monitor them. Okay. Engaging them online. They pretend that. Okay. They are learning. Fine. Language barrier. That's a very powerful. Yes. The language should be very powerful. Okay. You would have got participants from different parts of the world. Still, you should be able to reach them. Because it's not that only within the four walls of your classroom. Remember, limited. Fine. Then awareness. They should be able to aware of all the happenings in the digital platform. Okay. So feelings of isolation, another problem. Yes, I am not able to see all the audience. I'm being isolated. Still, I'm assuming that because I have been delivering my lecture in this platform many times, I don't have any problem. I'm assuming that everyone is sitting and seeing me. Okay. I'm able to just in my mind, I'm visualizing that without having any problem. But every participant may not have the same feeling, okay, feeling like isolation. Inadequate student support, yes, e-learning sometimes lead to this problem. Then poor network and internet facilities, okay. Your audio and video quality is based on this. Discomfort with the learning style, yes. Inadequate computer services. All the services available platform to platform vary. You see in the Zoom, in the demo trial version, you can deliver the content only for 40 minutes. Google Meet, you can have the participants in the trial version only up to 50. You see, limitations. Little training is required in using the software. Slow course website, sometimes the technical support. If I lead into any problem, morning, Dr. Venkatesh Babu and the system admin, they were helping me to put all my, the PowerPoint, everything. Fine. Comfortably, I don't have any problem. Fine. What are the issues, other issues and challenges? Learners' expectations. Expect more online. Yes, more expectations than classroom teaching. Readiness, learning styles, identity, yes, isolation is a problem. Then participation, you can measure the participation in the e-learning platform well. In the conventional learning, many times we ask the question at the end of the instruction. Here also we do it, but still you could see in the chat box all the questions. You could see it's parallel processing. I deliver the content, but I could see the chat box, what is their reaction. Institutional support, your institute should support for all this, infrastructural facilities, digital infrastructural facilities. Instructors, sorry for the interruption. In few minutes, I'll be winding up. Kindly mute your mic. Somebody is. Kindly mute your mic. Okay. Then instructors, issues, time management, teaching aids, content. Okay, how you can develop the content, deliver the content, to assignment.
I said, the element they can get from the data. I'm the class director.
Hello. Kindly mute your mic.
Elements, I apply the classes. All those elements.
Hello. Kindly mute your mic. Okay. Kindly mute your mic. Fine. Thank you. Just two slides. Two slides. I'm just completing. Okay. What are the top e-learning platforms available? Very powerful platforms today from our own ministry. National Digital Library. National Digital Library for the resources. Swayam Prabha. Number of channels. IQR, Vijay TV, Raj TV, different channels. Okay, on the educational side. Swayam is a very powerful platform where we are able to all the courses. Hello. Yes. So Swayam have CEC, UGC, NPTEL, courses launched by IIT system, AACTE, and then NITTR. We are also into the system. We are the national coordinator for the teacher education MOOC. What is MOOC? Massive open online courses. And then designed by the IIM for the management courses, IGNO also plays a role, NIOS. And then coming to NITT, what is National Institute Teacher Training Models? Okay, there are 8 models every teacher has to undergo today. in order to get their probationary period declared in every engineering college institution, AICTE is making the mandatory. Right now, we are offering this 8 modules courses. 8 modules. You can see the details of the modules in the NITT, you know, the Swayam platform. Okay. So all the things are very important for the teacher, because you would have got the content by earning your PhD, ME, master's degree and all that, but you may not be able to deliver the content. You may not be able to understand the learning styles. You may not be able to understand the curriculum. That is what the whole part of my discussion. You require a holistic education or an outcome-based education. You get the point. Need to understand the requirements of the learner, learner-centric, be a learner-centric. Understand the customer requirements. Okay, I conclude with all this. Yes, no technology can replace a teacher, but no teacher can be successful without making use of the technology. What is going to be tomorrow? Blended learning, not merely only online learning. Blending with online learning and face to face. You should have the advantages of both the system, then only learning will happen to the maximum. So thank you very much. You have learned many aspects of outcome-based education, digital learning, conventional teaching learning process. Finally, I say teaching learning process is very, very important when compared to the infrastructural facilities available in the campus. What is happening in the classroom is being decided. Who should be, you know, how he should be, how he will get the placement, how you will get the employment opportunities, how you will be a good citizen for this country. Thank you very much for your participation. Thank you very much to all of you. Thank you very much to the organizers.
Thank you. Thank you, sir. This is Dr. Venkatesh Babu from Bharat University.
Yes.
Thank you very much, sir, for being a resource person and sharing your expertise and knowledge with us.
Okay, thank you.
And we are, sir, any questions you have, you can send it to the chat box and we'll take the answers from the host. So kindly do not ask the questions on the mic, because it will be, the traffic is too much. So if you have any queries, please type the queries on the chat box. Do not attempt to speak on the microphone. We are not permitting speaking on the microphone because we have more than 700 participants. Now it's coming down. So please don't attempt to anything you have to say, please say it on the chat box. Or any questions, please say it on the chat box. Sir, you are receiving a lot of thank you messages, as you can see over there.
Thank you very much. I hope I have satisfied them, their requirements. I'm very happy.
Yes, sir. And even during the presentation, we received hundreds of messages complimenting you on your excellent presentation skill and also about the effectiveness of the PPT, sir. It was a very wonderful PPT.
Thank you. You can share among the participants. I don't
know. Sir, we'll have it. And we are hosting all the PPTs at the end of the day on the YouTube channel. So participants, so on behalf of the participants, sir, I thank you very much for sharing your expertise, experience, and spending your valuable time with all of us. Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Venkatesh Babu. Thank you for the opportunity given. Thank you very much to all the participants. All the best to all of you. Stay safe, be healthy, be bold. Face the challenges. We'll see. Thank you very much. Thank you.